greet you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
And let us pray. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires are known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. The second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Upon these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. O Almighty Lord and everlasting God, vouch, safe, we beseech thee, to direct, sanctify, and govern both our hearts and bodies in the ways of thy laws and in the works of thy commandments. That through thy most mighty protection, both here and ever, we may be preserved in body and soul through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
And let us pray. Today's prayer comes from the 19th Sunday in Trinity. Lord, we beseech thee, for as much as without thee we are not able to please thee, mercifully grant that thy Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Lesson is written in the 43rd chapter of the book of Isaiah, beginning at the 18th verse. Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild beasts will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches, for I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people who I formed for myself, that they might declare my praise. Yet you did not call upon me, O Jacob, but you have been weary of me, O Israel. You have not brought me your sheep for burnt offerings or honored me with your sacrifices. I have not burdened you with offerings or wearied you with frankincense. You have not bought me sweet cane with money or satisfied me with the fat of your sacrifices. But you have burdened me with your sins. You have wearied me with your iniquities. I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and I will not remember your sins. Here ends the lesson.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in reading responsibly those portions of Psalm 41 as printed in the bulletin. Blessed is he who considers the poor. The Lord delivers him in the day of trouble.
The Lord protects him and keeps him alive. He is called blessed in his name. Thou dost not.
The Lord sustains him on his sickbed. In his illness, thou healest all his infirmities. As for me, I said, O Lord, be gracious to me.
heal me, for I have sinned against thee.
My enemies say of me in malice, when will he die, and his name perish? And when one comes to see me, he utters empty words, while his heart gathers mischief. When he goes out, he tells it abroad. All who hate me whisper together about me. They imagine the worst for me. They say a deadly thing is fastened upon him. He will not rise again from where he lay. Even my bosom friend, in whom I trusted, who ate of my bread, has lifted his heel against me.
But will, O Lord, be gracious to me, and raise me up, that I may requite them.
By this I know that thou art pleased with me, and that my enemy has not triumphed over me. But thou hast overcome me because of my integrity, and set me in thy presence forever. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen. Glory be to the Father, and the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, now and ever, shall be, world without end. Amen.
The epistle is written in the fourth chapter of the letter to the Ephesians, beginning at the 17th verse. This I affirm and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them. Due to their hardness of heart, they have become callous and have given themselves up to greedy to practice every kind of uncleanness. You did not so learn Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him, as the truth is in Jesus. Put off your old nature, which belongs to your former manner of life, and is corrupt through deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and put on the new nature, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, putting away falsehood, let everyone speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be angry, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his hands, so that he may be able to give to those in need. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for edifying, as fits the occasion, that it may impart grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, in whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. Here ends the lesson.
Thanks be to God.
Trinity, now and ever, care.
Gospel of St. Matthew, starting in chapter 9, verse 1. Glory be to thee, O Lord. Jesus entered into a ship and passed over and came into his own city. And behold, they brought to him a man sick of the palsy, lying on a bed. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, be of good cheer, thy sins be forgiven thee. And behold, certain of the scribes said within themselves, This man blasphemeth. And Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, Wherefore think ye evil in your hearts? For whether it is easier to say, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, Arise and walk, so that ye may know that the Son of Man has the power on earth to forgive sins. Then said he to the sick of the palsy, Arise and take up thy bed, and go unto thine house. And he arose and departed to his house. But when the multitude saw it, they marveled and glorified God, which had given such power unto men. Praise be to thee, O Christ. Join with me now as we say and remember, recite, and affirm the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost to the Virgin Mary and was made man, and he was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. The third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father, and he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead. His kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets, and I believe one Catholic Apostolic Church, I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen. And so, Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. My rock, my Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. I've got a 2-hour sermon, so I recommend you get a pillow and maybe something to drink, snack. We'll be done by 1 o'clock, I promise. Some of the sermons I heard this week were pretty long. Anyway, it gave me great empathy. I will keep it tight, short. But the passage certainly could go with a 2-hour sermon or maybe 3 or 4 20, 30-minute sermons. But this passage that I'm speaking about is from the Epistle to the Ephesians, chapter 4. And it's a difficult passage to read because it has so many words in it. You know, sometimes when you read Scripture, it's like really succinct and summarized, and then sometimes it feels like the writer is just giving you every possible adjective and detail and specific illustration that he can. And so that's what happens here with Paul. He's writing to the church at Ephesus. If you remember last week, we talked about a church letter he started to Corinth, and in that, he's talking about the idea that there's going to be a weight in the meantime, or until I come again, or as you tarry. He sort of lays it out there like dot, dot, dot. Like all these things are going to happen. The church has a role to play, but do this until he comes again, is the actual phrase. So what he does is he's setting up this whole epoch right? Thousands of years now, where the church is supposed to have been busy doing God's work on the earth, advancing the kingdom of God, bringing light into the darkness, hope into despair, healing into sickness, right? This whole idea that God is colonizing earth with Christians. Some theologians describe it as D-Day, right? This moment where we invade the darkness with these church-infused people. So Paul's writing about that, and so he wrote that to the church in Corinth. He also writes that to the church at Ephesus. And he keeps talking about the same stuff. If you read these letters, you're going to be like, well, he said it differently, but basically he's saying the same thing that he said to the Thessalonians or to the other churches that he wrote to, maybe Philippi, or maybe it was the same as in Corinth. Or, you know, like you start to see the theme. He's trying to teach every church the same basic truths. And that is absolutely true here at Ephesus. Verse 17 of chapter 4 says, and this is Paul who's writing, so this I say and solemnly affirm together with the Lord, that you must no longer live as the unbelieving Gentiles live, in the futility of their minds and in foolishness and emptiness of their souls. For their moral understanding is darkened and their reasoning is clouded. They are alienated and self-banished from God. Interesting. Self-banished, right? And he talks about the life of God. In other words, they don't have a share in the life of God because of their willful ignorance and deep-seated spiritual blindness that is within them. Because they have a hard and insensitive heart. This is what Paul says. So he's talking about this callous and unfeeling, insensitive, hardened heart that is the condition of our hearts separated from God. Now, that sounds very Christian to say, but let me put it to you in another sense. Life hurts us. We get hurt. There are things that come into our lives that disappoint us. There are things that happen in our life where we're betrayed. When we put our trust in someone or something and it let us down. There are moments in our life where people actually hurt us because they were just evil. All of that accumulates. We go through life and it's like these things start to attach to us. And as we get a little bit further and a little bit further into our lives, the weight sometimes gets really heavy, right? We get really weighed down by life. And the gospel, this idea that Jesus Christ, being the Son of God, could literally step into all of that pain and touch it, is a revolutionary idea. But all of that pain and all of that baggage and all of that suffering occurs not on the outside, although you might have a few scars. 99.9% of everything I'm talking about is completely unseen. It is inside. And it is what the Greeks call the soul or the heart that is damaged. Paul, knowing his Greek, clearly identifies that and says this callousness, this hardness and insensitivity is in the heart. He's not talking about you have a stone physical heart. He's saying that you're so wounded and beat up by life that you have clenched and you will not be hurt again. Does that sound familiar? All right. Right? Now we're not talking Christian. Now we're talking real life. There are things in our life that have hurt us. And all tissue, I can tell you as a physician, that if you repeatedly wound a spot on your body over and over and over, it will do what? Thicken. Go look at a farmer's hands. They're not like our hands. Look at a stonemason's or a bricklayer's hands. Or where I was in Bar Harbor, the lobstermen. These guys have hands that have like sausage digits. They're not normal fingers. You couldn't put a ring on it if you had to. They're three times the size of a normal finger. And they can't even close their hands because they're so thick with callus, right? When you repeatedly injure something, your body responds. It forms layers upon layers upon layers, and it forms a callus. Why? So it's not hurting anymore. So you can grab something sharp or something heavy or really coarse so it doesn't cut your skin anymore because your body's built up resistance to it. When Paul's talking about a calloused heart, and that's the literal translation, he's saying that your heart has been rubbed raw over and over and over by things in your life. And you had no other protection but to form a callus. Does that make it easier to understand? I've heard Christian preachers over the years talk about this as if people were just calloused in their heart and they had resisted God and didn't want anything to do with God, all in a vacuum, like they were just mean people. And I got to thinking about that. I was like, that's not really the case here. These are people who've been beat up by life. And they have self-banished themselves. They have said to God, I know I'm not going to be around the church because maybe the church was one of those things that hurt them. Right? So this idea then of what Paul is describing in Ephesus is he's saying, look, there's all kinds of things that have created a gap between us and God that has separated us from the life that Christ promises to us if we believe and trust him. And so he's really creating a huge description here. And he does this with most of the churches. He talks about his life before Christ, his old man, and he talks about his new man, his life after Christ. And he describes it not from his career or his clothing or where he lived or any of his external sort of details about his life. He describes it exclusively from the perspective of his soul, his heart. So everything he talks about, he's looking at it through the lens of his heart. He's saying, look at how my heart was changed by my experience with Christ. Now that is very, very important because if you just read these lists that he writes, he talks about don't do these things and he names them off. And then he says, I want you to do these things and he names them off. And that's essentially what the epistle's reading today says. It's a list of don't do this and it's a list of please do that. But if that's all you get from the reading, you're missing the bigger picture. It just goes out of your head, right? Because what he's talking about is a heart issue. He's not talking about good discipline, devotion, and religiousness. He's not talking about that. He's talking about something much deeper than the external. He's talking about the stuff that no one else can see. He's talking about who has captured our heart. I want you to think about your first love. Go ahead. I'll give you full permission. Remember that feeling of someone had captured your heart? I'll embarrass my wife. She's downstairs. I walked into a room in 1989. It was in Decatur, Illinois, which is the armpit of Illinois. And you would never want to go to Decatur, Illinois. It has a massive soybean plant called Staley's. Stinks. Smells awful. And I was playing football with some guys intramurally, and they went to this called InterVarsity. I thought it was a sports thing. It was a Bible study. Anyway, I walked into this room at this state park, and they had a cabin rented and everything. And I looked across this room, and the most beautiful woman I had ever seen was sitting talking to another man. And inside of me, I said, "That's not right. I should be sitting there talking to her." What happened? She captured my heart. From that moment until the day we got married, and I chased her, right? Like, she had my heart. I would have jumped off of whatever cliff face I had to win her heart. And I did. I chased her heart. I won her back, right? Capturing your heart is what Paul's really trying to describe in this passage. He's saying that if you experience Christ like he did, it will capture your heart. And in doing so, if you surrender that heart, that soul of yours, that painfully callous and broken piece of you, if you give that to him, he says, you'll never go back to that old stuff. He's only listing it as a reference. It's not his focus. He's like, well, this is what I used to do. This is how I used to think. This is how I was trapped in this negative downward spiral. And then in Christ now, suddenly I'm living completely different. I treat people different. I experience life different. I see the world different. Why? Because Christ has captured his heart. So he is choosing to follow after Christ out of love, not obligation. So what you're reading here is more of a love letter than a legalistic description of what not to do. I came across a really good explanation of this. I want to share it with you. It was written by a pastor named Chuck Smith. Those who've read the classics are probably familiar with the story of Ulysses. During his travels, this ancient adventurer heard the stories of the island of the Sirens, deadly enchantresses who made up beautiful music that any sailor passing by would turn their ship toward shore, dashed upon the rocks and drown. No one had ever lived and heard the song of these sirens. This sounded to Ulysses like a worthy challenge, for he was a daring man. He decided he would become the first to hear the sirens' music and survive. In order to achieve his goal, Ulysses put wax in the ears of his crew and instructed his men to tie him securely to his ship's mast. As they rowed past the island of the sirens, the seductive music began. Ulysses began to strain against the ropes, struggling to get free so he could swim to the shore. He cursed at his sailors and begged them to turn the boat towards the rocks. But the sailors had wax in their ears and it prevented them from hearing his cries. But Ulysses continued to fight against his bonds, and he kept fighting until the ship moved out of range of the siren's song and back to safety. You see, Ulysses had heard the song of the sirens and lived, yet ever after he was haunted by the beguiling music and its memory. Greek myths also tell of another ship that passed this island and survived, and its crew was being drawn by the deadly melody to the disaster of the shoals. A gifted man on board named Orpheus grabbed a lyre and he began to play. The music of Orpheus so far surpassed that of the sirens that the men turned away from the rocks and sailed to safety, enraptured by these new exquisite melodies that gave them life. God's desire is not that you go around in chains all day, trying to keep yourself from temptations. God's desire is that you hear the beautiful song of our Savior, and that you would fall so in love with him and his ways that the old life would no longer have an appeal. Interesting, right? A I believe this is what Paul is trying to explain to the church. Paul is describing how his heart has been captured by Christ. And he uses a specific language. It's really interesting language. The verse that he refers to is from our passage, verse 20 of Ephesians 4. And they, the ungodly, having become callous and unfeeling, have given themselves over to unbridled sensuality, eagerly craving the practice of every kind of impurity. But you did not learn Christ in this way. In fact, you have heard him and been taught by him, just as the truth is revealed in his life. Interesting. If you read that, and Lindsay did a great job, it's a lot of words, but it doesn't flow correctly. It's not English in the way we're used to speaking it. It is different. It says that they were not, you did not learn Christ that way. That seems like an inappropriate way of saying something. You did not learn Harriet in this way. What do you mean learn Harriet? Like, I learn about Harriet, right? So when I first read that, I just naturally filled in that extra word, because that's how we speak. You don't learn about Christ. You don't learn about Peter. You don't learn about people. But it says, no, it says in the Greek, you did not learn Christ in that way. Okay, well, why did he say it that way? I believe he said it that way because you cannot learn about Christ. You have to learn Christ. What does that mean? The disciples spent 3 years following him around. They watched him. They observed him. They saw him react and act in different ways to every kind of situation. They didn't learn about Christ. They learned Christ. It wasn't so much that we study Christ intellectually or that we have some better education and understanding because we've read Scripture. These 4 subdeacons that are in training, we got to know some details about the Bible and our faith and history and the theology and traditions of the church, but that's not the essentials. The essentials is learning Christ. You cannot learn about Christ without being close to him. Those 12 that he had as his disciples, they lived with him. They were in immediate proximity to him for 3 years. They got as close as touching him every day, right? I believe what Paul's saying through these Greek words, through these big picture ideas, and through this comparison between the old life and the new, he's saying that as the church, we're never going to colonize earth if we just follow Christ out of obligation or a sense of duty. That's not going to change anything. It certainly won't change us. Instead, he's saying you're going to have to get close enough to learn Christ by touching him, being in his presence, right? If you do that, he will capture your heart. And the moment you surrender your heart to Christ, he'll heal it. And you will no longer long for or be seduced by anyone else. Right? That's the message here. It's not the do and don't list. That just is natural. You fall in love with somebody, you don't want to do the things that would hurt them, and you do want to do the things that make them happy. Right? Like, that's just given. Like, you don't have to explain that to a young couple. Like, man, you should really not do those things because that really hurts her. He's like, oh, I will never do that. Right? Well, of course he will eventually. Like, we got to work on that later. But in the flush of the moment, man, he's in love. He'll sleep on a bed of nails to be near her, right? You understand, I had two daughters. When the guys would come looking for my girls, they were dressed nice and smelled good, and they'd really shaved, even if they didn't need to. And they were prim and proper. Yes, sir. No, sir. It's nice to meet you, sir. This isn't the real man. This is the one that's trying to get my daughter, right? There's a process where when your soul is captured by Christ, you're not worried about what you can't do. You're just too excited about what you can do. Now that is the heart of the Saint Paul that I read. He's not emphasizing all the stuff you can't do anymore because you're a Christian. He's excited about all the new things he's experiencing because he is. Now that will change the world. That could change this community, right? Because he goes on to say that if Christ has captured your heart, you're not all filled up with all the negative, nasty, cynical, critical stuff of the world. And he names them all. He goes, reject all falsehood. Speak the truth. Don't be a liar. But don't be angry and sin. Be kind. Don't hold a grudge. He says, don't steal. Don't let unwholesome, vulgar words come out of your mouth. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit. And in all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor, be gone. Don't let it be around you. And be kind and helpful to one another, tenderhearted and compassionate, forgiving each other as Christ forgave you. It's almost like he can't say it fast enough. He's like, I found Jesus. Jesus healed my broken, callous heart. And look at all the stuff now that I don't want to do anymore and all the stuff I do want to do. And it's amazing. You can almost feel like this guy's in a manic phase as he's writing. He's that excited. That sounds like someone in love to me. Oh my gosh, I used to write love letters to my wife before she was my wife. They make no sense. She kept them. I've read them. It's drivel. Absolute mindless slobbering testosterone fueled drivel. But I meant it. I'm not suggesting that St. Paul is writing mindless drivel. I am suggesting that he's in love with Christ and that it's a permanent condition. And that in falling in love with Christ, he actually stopped hearing the world. No one has to go along behind St. Paul and go, dude, don't look at that. Don't touch that. Sir, you shouldn't do that. Like, there's nobody keeping track of St. Paul. Why? Because he's in love. Exactly. Someone might be following in Poppy's footsteps. Let's close with prayer. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for Paul and his amazing writing and just the fact that he so loved you. He's really led a way for us to follow in. And so may the calluses be broken from our hearts today. And may we get close enough to touch you with the sacrament of the Eucharist. I'm going to say these words in a few minutes together, that you could be in us and we in you. That's touching. That's in the body and the blood of Christ. That's intimacy. That's touching you. So may we touch you anew today. And may it heal us. In Jesus' holy name. Amen. Remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. of Christ Church. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle has taught us to make prayer and supplication, and give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and our oblations, and to receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word, and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also so to direct and dispose the hearts of all Christian rulers, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. Unto all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And so we pray for Anne, who's in hospice. We pray for Michael, who's struggling with depression. For Jenny, who has congestive heart failure and an embolism. For Matthew, that you'd save his heart, his soul from hell. I pray for John and Dee Kelly, who are both fighting cancer and in hospice. We pray for Pauline, who has Parkinson's. For Dan, with shingles. And for Mike, who's fighting deep depression. For prodigals that have lost their way in their faith, that you draw them back. We pray for Alicia, that you give her stability and consistency, mental health. We pray for Jacob, direction in his life. For Sarah and Philip Tarantino, fighting cancers right now, for stage 4 lung cancer and prostate cancer. We pray for our dear sister Linda Monroe, who has severe arthritis. For Julia, who has a brain tumor. For Kristen, who has MS and is spiritually exhausted. Pray for Heather and Steve, who a disaster in their home. We remember our dear sister Ann Wilcox. And Father, we pray for this season of our world, the upcoming election, for your will to be done. And we ask for your men and women to be elected, that you would direct and rule their hearts. And so we bless your holy name for all thy servants who departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
Ye who do truly and earnestly repent of your sin, and are in love and charity with your neighbor, and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God, devoutly kneeling. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ,
Maker of all things,
Judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us.
We rejoice in your hand, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all our trespasses, and grant that we may ever have sure and please thee with this life, to the honor and glory of thy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sin to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him. Have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what comfortable words our Savior Christ has said unto all those who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, I will refresh you. So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Here also what St. Paul saith, and this is a true saying, it's worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Here also what St. John says, if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
And lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
And let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It
is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to thee, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God. Therefore, with the angels, the archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord Most High. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. A couple of reminders before we start this most sacred part of our liturgy. As Anglicans or Anglican Catholics, we believe there is something that occurs mystically, supernaturally, from the words that I say and the symbols that I use with my hands that changes this bread and this wine. It is not just bread and wine. Not after this ceremony. And so as we approach this moment, it is significant that we align our hearts with the Holy Spirit. We are literally inviting Christ to be present in the bread and in the wine. So when you come forward in a few moments to receive the bread and the wine, you are now inviting Christ to become present in you, and you in him. And this will be said in the liturgy repeatedly. I want to point that out to you. It's sacred, it's familiar, but it should never become mundane. It should always hold an air of mystery to it, because Christ is unfathomable. We cannot understand completely who he is and what he did, but we can sense it. So when we go through these next few moments, it's long, and these paragraphs can be lengthy, and you may know the words, but I want to make sure that in your heart, you are true to those words. Okay. All glory be to thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for that thou of thy tender mercy did give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his one oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, thy humble servants, do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty with these thy holy gifts, which we now offer to thee, the memorial thy Son has commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion, precious death, his mighty resurrection, glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless, sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer, present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us, and we in him. And although we are unworthy, through our manifold sin, to offer to thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this, our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, In the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy
kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with thy spirit.
We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his blood, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may ever dwell in him, he in us.
Amen.
Behold, this is the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world.
Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God,
We must heartily thank thee for that us have saved to feed us. We have duly received these holy mysteries,
which are spiritual food and the promise of our life and blood, and our Savior, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Thus assure us, dear God, of thy favor and goodness towards us,
and that we are
very members of the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of his most precious death and passion. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. And so, Father, I pray for all the calloused hearts among us, all of those wounds that we've accumulated in our life. May they be healed by the presence of Christ. And may we practice his presence on a regular basis. May we come and touch the Savior every day. May we find ourselves close to you. Show us how. Give us the desire. Help us to fall in love with you. We ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. Glory be to God on high and on earth, peace and goodwill towards men. We praise thee. We bless thee. We worship thee. We glorify thee. We give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, God the Father Almighty.
O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. O Lord God, Lamb of God, the Son of God, that takes away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takes away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us.
For thou only art holy. Thou only art the Lord. Thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. You would stand. Now, in the past, I've explained this as me throwing a softball kind of thing, and you catch it and carry this with you. I want you to think one step further. I want you to invade the world with a bazooka of peace. I want you to bring peace into every relationship and conversation and environment that you step into once you leave this church. Traditionally, in the Catholic and the Anglican faith, this idea of a benediction is the idea of me sending you out with the presence of Christ within you to colonize earth. The idea that we would bring joy and peace and hope into the world because of what we've experienced together here today, right? So this is a benediction, but it's really more of a commission. It's like you are going to go do something with what you've received today. All right. Ready? Are you ready?
Yes.
Ready.
The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. And the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost be among you and remain with you.
Always.
Amen.